How's it going, my people? It's your boy Wired Up, and welcome to Wired Up TV. Hope you guys got your hand on your steering wheel and keeping your eyes on the road. Handle your business no matter what it is, guys. You guys have problems at home, you guys have problems at school, at work, you guys have problems, you motherfuckers got fucking your house about to be taken away because you motherfuckers got addicted to some dope or got hooked up with a fucking junkie bitch that you got all pussy whooped and don't know how to dump her because you're a nice fucking little weenie. It's all good, my brothers and sisters. You can fix that. For the weenies, grow some motherfucking balls, kick that girl to the curb, and find yourself a real woman because there's plenty of them out there. Don't let a bad woman ruin a good thing for a real woman. Now, if you're losing your house because you're addicted to dope, kick it. No matter what it is, man, after 2 weeks, you'll be cool. Kick that motherfucking shit. Go get a job. Start saving money. Get your shit together. Drop all the habits, and you'll be all right. Now, with that said, guys, God bless you guys, and let's get on with the motherflowering video.
That day, I remember we was at his Malibu house, you know what I mean? And, you know, he initiated me as an outlaw, you know what I'm saying? He was like, you the last one, you the seventh member, you know what I mean? You make the cipher complete. He was like, you got to be better than everybody. I was the youngest, you know what I'm saying? So, you know.
Well, you didn't have a name.
Now, did you hear what Noble just said? Just one thing that I want to start out with, guys. He's talking about the number seven. Tupac, the 7 day theory. It took him 7 days to supposedly pass away, but you know, 7 days to fake his death. Just seven sevens everywhere. You know what I'm saying? The day was September 7th. You feel me? It's just crazy. 777. He's trying to tell us something with the sevens. You know what I'm saying? You know, Tupac had a lot of different beliefs. He was growing up. He was, you know, a smart guy, so he was studying every single thing. He wasn't just getting stuck on one thing. So, you know, he was very into, you know, the music industry. So he hung around with a lot of Masonic people. And Masonic people are not necessarily bad people. And, you know, I believe his numerical game was up. And, you know, he was trying to speak to you with the game, with the numbers. You know, so people couldn't catch it too quick. And he can talk to you guys again.
I really want you guys to peep this and pay real close attention to this, guys, okay? Listen very
Machiavelli
carefully.
Machiavelli shit, this Machiavelli records, euthanasia, this film, all this shit, you know what I mean? So that's what I feel like. When he got out, he was just a ball of energy, man. We was kids.
He talked a lot about the future.
You know what I mean?
You know what I mean? He talked about a lot about the future, but also he knew the possibilities. So, you know, he would prep us in case certain shit happened and tell us certain things that he wanted us to do if he did pass, but that man was thinking about the future.
Definitely.
You know what I mean? He was setting his life up for the future.
I'm gonna be honest, he used to talk about shit like that. Like, yo, if I die, da 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 da. We used to be like, nigga, we gonna be dead too. Like, we with you every day. You know what I'm saying? So we ain't used to wanna hear that if I die talk. Like, get out of here, man. We don't wanna hear that shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? We focus, man. But he used to, you know, bring that up every once in a while, but
sure.
You know, he was definitely thinking ahead, bro. Like, this guy was...
It wasn't an everyday thing. That's
nah,
what he was
talking
about
dying. I remember this dude was, you know, he was talking about us building a compound, man. He was like, yo, telling you, we about to get so much fucking money, you know, we gonna... I want y'all to save y'all publishing checks and we gonna build a compound underground for all our goddamn families, man. He was thinking that kind of shit at 25 years old, man.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? Like, the world is fucked up, man. You know what I mean? He like, yo, the worst case scenario, if them bombs start dropping, we gonna survive, man. Outlaws will be still around this motherfucker, underground. You know what I mean?
Crazy.
That guy was ahead of his time, man. You know?
So at the time...
How's it going, my people? Did you hear that? That's one thing I've been wanting to talk to you guys about. He's talking about... Listen to the way they're speaking, okay? Because the Outlaws and everybody else involved with Tupac, like the family, they don't want to give up his location. Okay, because, you know, their family, don't, Tupac, don't do it. Because you might get killed and they might try to arrest you. But, you know, Pac's a writer. He did what he did. He said, for my peoples, I'm going to keep it real. I don't give a fuck. You know what I'm saying? So, listen to what he's saying. He said, that man was thinking about the future. Listen really close to what he's saying. That man was thinking about the future. He was ahead of his time. If I die this way, if I die that way. He was trying to let him know, look, man, I'm planning my death. So y'all peep game. Y'all be good. Y'all, you know, look out.
and stuff like that. He was trying to speak to them. And I know they got it because, like I said, a lot of people probably didn't get it right at the beginning. But with the time passing, especially the family, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm pretty sure he got in touch with them. Finally came to grips. You know what I'm saying? That Tupac had survived. Because I'm pretty sure not everybody in the family knew this. Now, I really want you guys to peep the rest of this interview. And talk to you right
now. They ended up on songs like Heaven Ain't Hard to Find, Picture Me Rolling.
Yeah.
Because they definitely had a musical chemistry.
Yeah. Danny Bud was talented on the spot. Like, you know, Pac said, yo, hop on this. Yeah.
And Pac liked working with people that right. can... deliver right away, you know what I mean?
Get it done and get the fuck out of there.
That nigga's, you know, he on that mission, so if you right. can't keep up.
So, did you hear Edie, I mean? He on that mission. So, if you can't keep up, keep it moving. He liked to mess with people in the studio creatively that were going to be able to push out songs quick because he had a limited amount of time and he knew it. He knew it. And they're trying to tell you guys, you know, I've told you guys, I've spoken to many people in the family, different places. And I can't go straight out and tell you what they told me because I haven't gotten that permission yet. But I'm telling you guys, listen to what they're telling you. Listen real close to what they're telling you guys. Okay? They're trying to talk to you, but not give you everything. You know, you have to work for it. You know what I'm saying? The game ain't free. Okay, he liked to mess with, you know, mess with people in the studio that were quick because he was on a mission. He was ahead of his time. They're trying to tell, you know what I'm saying? He chose to leave quietly. That's what Afeni said. These are all signs and clues that the family is giving you guys so you guys can find out what's going on. You know what I'm saying? This channel here is for Pac, though. We're here to find him. We're here to solve the puzzle he created 23 years ago, okay? And we're gonna solve it, guys. If it's the last thing we do, this channel is for us. It's for the people, y'all. You know what I'm saying? Y'all need to peep what we're talking about over here, okay? Because we're trying to solve this shit. We're trying to get answers, okay? We're talking to the families. We're talking to everybody. We're not just sitting there looking at pictures and standing around. You know what I'm saying? The whole Tupac community is getting up and trying to do something. You know what I'm saying? So y'all get with this real shit and join in. Join the fun, guys. You know what I'm saying? But they're trying to speak to all of us in code, basically. Not wanting to give you the whole pie, just a little piece, little by little. You feel me? But he's alive, guys, and he's here. And these videos are jewels. That's why it's very important that we keep these people talking, that we keep his family talking, everybody talking. That's very important, okay? Because the more they talk, the more they're going to give us. And the more they give us. You know what I'm saying? And that's what's up, yo. I want you guys to listen to what he just said. Hell for a Hustler. Still I Rise. The Outlaws and Machiavelli. That's the album. But I want you guys to hear what he said, okay? This is what he said. He said, niggas act like they catch the Holy Ghost when I approach them. Niggas act like they caught the Holy Ghost when I approach them. Because when his enemies or people see him, they act like they caught the Holy Ghost because he should be dead. They act like they see the ghost. We need to know how to unscramble these things and how to listen to when people speak to you. You can't always just listen to something and go, okay, well, that's it. Some people are trying to tell you something. Some people are, you know, are speaking in code. You know what I'm saying? There's people that are so smart when there's people in distress. Like, let's say somebody answers the door and somebody has a gun to their head. There's people that can, you know, and but they're hiding behind the door. There's people that just by looking at the victim can tell that she's in distress, okay? You have to pay attention and you have to be alert, guys. They act like they caught the Holy Ghost when I approached him. He's telling you because when they see him, they act like seeing a ghost because he should be dead, but he's not dead. He's alive. He's trying to tell you all that, okay? Now, this next one makes me feel very uncomfortable talking about it. but it's something I've been asked about a lot. And people ask me to look into it. There's this theory out there. And it's on a couple of channels as well on YouTube. That talks about that Tupac, his whole image was made up. He was put there by the government, the CIA, to infiltrate the black community and destroy the rap movement and all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? And one of them, you know, is that he's a police officer, right? CIA, right? And this song says, and, you know, it says this, and this is what something that caught my attention while doing the research, and this came out of Tupac's own mouth. And I really need somebody to explain this to me because I try to look at it in every other way, and I can't seem to grasp any other motive or any other reason why he would say this, but the one I'm about to tell you now. Okay, he says, and if the cops come arrest me in the morning, best believe they're coming for my dogs in the evening. Why? Is he gonna tell on him? Is he telling on them? You know what I mean? Were he and Snoop Dogg actually both cops? You know what I'm saying? That were brought to infiltrate every, you know, death row, you know, and the rap movement because they had fear that it was gonna be just like the Black Panthers. And they was going to stir up some shit. You know what I'm saying? I don't necessarily believe in this, but I respect everybody's opinion. And here on Wired Up TV, we talk about everything. Okay? But this comment really caught my attention. If the cops come arrest me in the morning, best believe they're coming for my dogs in the evening. When I heard that, that rattled my brain. Okay? I've been doing research on all this stuff. And you know what I'm saying? Seeing that Tupac has Jewish background. You know what I'm saying? His name being changed. First, it was LaShawn Parrish Crooks. You know, they think that his mom took a deal and they both went into protective custody and Pac ended up being a CIA agent. That's when his name was changed. Well, both of their names were changed. You know what I'm saying? And the infiltration of the community was to begin. Because Tupac's mom was looking at a lot of time. Okay? Now, that's, you know, what my research has led me to learn all that, okay? It's interesting to look at it and things like that, okay? I'm still going to look at it more. I respect everybody's beliefs, and that's all I got to say about that. That comment really got me, though. It really pulled me. If the cops come arrest me in the morning, best believe they're coming for my dogs in the evening. What does that mean?
I just wanted to clear my throat.
You lost Best Rap Video. You all disappointed about that?
Oh, no, I didn't lose, see, because I sold 6.5 million copies, so I won.
When all these famous people get together, what's the one thing you take away? Is everybody much shorter than you thought? I know a lot of people find Snoop and say, you know, 6'4", I had no idea.
Oh, yeah.
But do people seem shorter? There's a lot of attitude going on. What's the one thing you take away?
Oh, it's a lot of attitude, of course, because nobody thought we would show up here. But, you know, we always feel like we're keeping it real. Scratch that. We always felt like we're being true to everything we've always stayed representing. And our audience is worldwide. We're not even on no, you know, we're coming out here and it's some East Coast, West Coast. We got beef with the people we got beef with. But we could go anywhere in the country because we are America's most wanted.
Exactly.
So you can't stop the flow.
Can't stop what America wants.
Right. On that note, I know that Biggie and Puffy are here tonight. Did you see them? Do you have anything to say to them at all?
Nah, but if we saw them, we are businessmen. We are not animals. It's not like we're gonna see them and rush them and jump on them. If they see us and they want the drama, we're gonna definitely bring it like only Death Row could bring it. But we here as businessmen to enjoy and support the Video Music Awards for MTV because they support us. What? So if they wanna come and use this business opportunity to get on some gangster, you know, we do that better than anybody.
Can you envision a day when, you know, y'all, if not get together and make an album, just peacefully coexist.
There's no dream of making an album with Biggie and Puffy, or none of them. We're not sweating it like that.
This is our family.
We peacefully coexist right now because we all cool. Everybody's here. Everybody's they sell records. We sell records. Well, I guess you could call that selling records, what they do. We sell large amounts of records, and they sell a few records. And really, it's no competition. People are really making too much out of it than it is. It's really just, if you want to talk, we're gonna make it specific as to what you can talk about and what you can't talk about. And the East Coast, West Coast thing is something that the journalists and people are making up just to get paid off it so it can drag out. So they're perpetuating it so it could be drama, which I still love MTV, but when it all go down, don't look at me and Biggie and be like, why is there a big East Coast, West Coast war when you're shooting this to 300 homes, 300 countries, telling them about an East Coast, West Coast war that they would never know exists. So that's where information becomes a problem. When
and if it did,
news,
if
gotta
it,
be,
if it
be
did
the
exist,
let you know.
If it did exist, Pac, we wouldn't be here. So
right, and if it exists,
you know,
how we gonna be sitting in New York talking about it? We'll try to be better role models, and y'all try to stop putting that drama out there. You got a lot of power, a lot of responsibility. We both do. We both need to exercise.
Guys, did you guys see that and notice that? Sorry. Tupac will not let Snoop Dogg talk. He will not let him catch a word in. He looks like he's very agitated, aggravated with just his presence there, because he knows he's a cop. And I think Snoop can feel that. Snoop's those type of guys. He's a quiet guy, and he feels a lot. He can feel Pac. You can see it in his face. And Pac's treating him like a snitch. Like he just found out this nigga has been talking shit behind his back. You know what I'm saying? He just found out some bullshit like that. That's how he's acting, right? So look closely at his reaction. Snoop Dogg is a police officer. This is why I've been telling you guys that over and over, because it's true, guys. He's a police officer, and Pac knows it. And you can just see it in Snoop Dogg's eyes. You could just see it. You know, a lot of people have talked about this before, but they've talked about it in that he was punking Snoop. No, remember, guys, Snoop had just said that shit about Biggie, and Tupac was keeping his eye on him, right? And Snoop's advisors, his you know, chief at the FBI firm or CIA office was telling him and putting pressure on him and saying, you got to get him to Vegas because we need to try to get his ass in Vegas. We got to try to kill him in Vegas. And Snoop Dogg was worried. He knew, well, shit, Pac's not talking to me. Did I fuck up by saying this about Biggie? Oh, fuck, did I do this? Did I do that? Did I just fuck up? He's a young officer. He doesn't know if he just fucked the whole thing up. That's why he keeps asking Tupac, are you going to Vegas, cuh? Are you going to Vegas, cuh? Are you going to Vegas, cuh? Are you going to Vegas? Because he's afraid that he fucked up by saying that. His officials are telling him, you need to get him to Vegas, and Snoop feels like he's not going to be able to get Pac to Vegas because of what he said on the radio about Biggie. So he's like, Pac, are you going to Vegas? He's trying to make sure to triple, double, quadruple check. He's going. He's nervous. He doesn't know if he's doing his job right. He was just put there for months undercover, and he didn't know if he was going to fuck it up, guys. Look deep. You got to watch the streets. The streets will eat you alive. A lot of you guys that have never been to prison, that haven't spent a lot of time in the streets, all respect, that's good. You don't want to end up in there. Shit, that's props. But something that you have to watch out for is these grimy motherfuckers, and there's plenty of them. You've heard of homeboys, or even those you guys that didn't grow up in, you know, kind of suburban neighborhoods, you know, if you want to call it that, have, you know, known people that, or heard of people that have just disappeared and done time. Somebody snitched on them and undercover, you sold to an undercover. Well, how do you think that they get caught? You know what I'm saying? These guys go undercover for months. They get their trust. They get to know their friends. Some of them even go as far as getting fake identity, fake houses, fake cars. The government gives them fake money. This shit goes in deep. The CIA does not play, especially when you got Tupac and Biggie with the power to start to send people to go kill people. Biggie got on the radio and said, Tupac and Snoop and the Dog Pound are making a video and somebody tried to kill him. That's the power they had, guys. Okay, you guys listen to that. And then Tupac, you know, had a you know, he had a fucking feather trigger finger, man. This guy, anything set him off. So he could start a riot. He can get somebody killed quick. I want you guys to think about that and comment, guys. I gave you guys a lot of food to chew on. you know what I'm saying, and have a full belly and think about this. Comment and let me know. You guys got any new information, let me know. Or send it to wiredup.tv4u@gmail.com and get your credit and shout out, guys. We keep it real here. The channel is for y'all. You guys keep your head up, keep positive and shit. And like, you know, like I always tell you guys, always stay wired up. Okay, my friends? Stay good, guys. Peace out. I'll see you guys later.